Now, dear Lord, thy word to study today. Give us wisdom and we'll give God the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. I have a message on my heart today for you that I feel will be enlightening to some if you will just listen carefully. Now, we are living in perplexing times. We're living in tremendous days, and we are living in the age of change. Everything seems to be changing today, but God's Word doesn't change. Now, we're living in the age when many are crying out to church people, to preachers and Christians, to take the middle of the road. In other words, don't be an extremist. Don't be an extremist either in modernism or in fundamental Bible Christianity. Don't be a fanatic. In other words, be a middle-of-the-road man or a middle-of-the-road woman and take the middle line. Now, there's another thing that we hear today, and that is God is love, God is love. Preach positive, positive, positive. Now, I was at a certain meeting not so long ago, and an outstanding religionist made the statement that we should never judge any man. We don't know whether a man's a modernist or not, or whether he's catering to modernism, and we should never judge. But you know, the Bible says, by their fruits ye shall know them. Now, I can hear a man preach a very few times. In fact, I scarcely need to hear the average man preach but one time, and I can tell you how much he hates the devil and hates sin and how mad he is with the forces that are damning humanity like water pours over the falls. Now listen, there are seven distinct clear statements in the Word of God concerning the negative part of Christian living. Now I'm a positive preacher. I believe in positive preaching. I believe that we're saved by grace through faith. I believe that salvation is positive. But, beloved, we need today not to be a middle-of-the-road or a one-sided Christian or a half-baked cake. We need to take the whole counsel of God and study to show ourselves approved unto God, workmen that needed not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth, and accepting the Word of God as it's laid down in the Bible and accept it as it applies to our own heart. Now, I say today that I had rather follow the Apostle Paul and the admonition of the Apostle Paul than any man that's alive today. And, of course, these words that I'm going to read to you today are inspired words. They are not the words of a man, but they are the Word of God, inspired, dictated to men of God. Now, first of all, let me just read through these that I want you to notice. Number one, be not. That's negative. Number two, touch not. All right? That's negative. Number three, love not. That's negative. Number four, set not. That's negative. Number five, walk not. That's negative. Number six, give not. All right? Give not. That's negative. And number seven, enter not. Enter not. Now, all seven of them are negative. Be not, touch not, love not, set not, walk not, give not, enter not. Now, those are negatives, and there's seven of them. And my friend, I'm saying you today, unless you are an absolute atheist or an agnostic, or unless you are the rankest of modernists, then God bless you, you'll have to accept this as the infallible Word of God and the admonition of God to His children. Now, first of all, Paul, and he doesn't say all of these. I'll tell you about all of them as we go along. Paul, in 2 Corinthians 6:14, Paul says, be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Be not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Now, in the name of common sense, I can understand to save my life how some professing Christians and people who claim to be following God and some people who claim to be fundamental Bible believers, how in the name of common sense they sanction and support and stand by and stand with what they stand by. I can understand it to save my life. Be not unequally yoked with unbelievers. How much fellowship does a child of God have with an infidel And, beloved friends, I say that any man that denies the verbal inspiration of the Bible, he's worse than an infidel, because an infidel says, I don't believe any of it. An infidel laughs and scoffs and mocks at God, and some of these modernists believe in God, they say, and yet they deny the Word of God. They accept the part that they want to accept, and they deny the rest of it. But I want to say that we are not to be unequally yoked together. Now, if you are supporting a program, a religion, a man, or whatever it is you're supporting, and that man is not out and out for God, if he's not a man or a woman, as the case might be, in a Sunday school class or some kind of an assembly, if you're supporting any person that does not believe in the fundamentals of the faith and does not preach the fundamentals of the faith, then I want to say you are unequally yoked with an unbeliever. And when you support them with your time, your presence, your prayers, and your money, you are a partaker of their evil deeds. Now, I believe that it goes deeper than that. I believe that this verse of Scripture should be applied to marriage, to business, to society. Now, I read the other day, I was reading out of a very old book. You know, every once in a while, the devil gets right straddle of my neck, and he says, Oliver Green, you're a fool. You're crazy. You're a crackpot. Why don't you tone down and simmer down? And why don't you preach like some other folks do? And you wouldn't have to worry about finances and crowds. You'd have them if you wouldn't be so wild and fanatical. But you know, I get to thinking about that, and the old devil gets right straddling my neck, and he says, you're crazy, you're a crackpot, you're a religious fanatic. And then I pick up a book like a book I picked up, written by a man in the 18th century, and I read in there where this dear man fought like a tiger everything that I'm fighting today, then I say, glory to God. If I'm a fool, then thank God I am, and I'm standing with the old war horses of God of the past, and I'm standing with the men today who fight just like I fight. Everything that looks like the devil, acts like him, walks like him, talks like him, or smells like him, I'm going to fight everything that's not righteous. Anything that's not righteous is unrighteous. Anything that's not godly is ungodly. Anything that's not pure is impure, and anything that's not fundamental is modernistic. And God bless you, I want you to understand that I'm out and out for God, and I believe everything the Bible says, and I refuse to sell my convictions for crowds, prestige, money, or anything else. You're listening to the voice of one Baptist preacher that's not for sale. Now remember that. I'm going to preach the naked, unvarnished. Be not unequally yoked together. I'm not going to support a modernist. I'm not going to support a modernistic church. I'm not going to support a modernistic preacher. I'm not going to support a modernistic Sunday school teacher. I'm not going to support a modernistic religion. I'm going to support the blood of Jesus Christ. I'm going to support the verbal inspiration of the Bible. And I refuse to support anything else. I will not. I refuse to do it. Be not. That's negative. Be not. Now then, I heard a fellow say the other day, well, Brother Green, don't you know that the only way that we can help the modernist is to associate with him and take him in and try to show him his wrong? I tell you, brother, that sounds so much like the Pharisees that the Son of God said, you're whited sepulchers full of dead men's bones. I tell you, that is so old it has whiskers. Amen. That's so old it's not even funny. It's not even cute. That's the same old ungodly argument that we've had down through the age. Take them in. Fellowship with them. You must... Listen, I'll sit at a bootlegger's table and eat with him and talk with him and reason with him about his soul. I won't drink his liquor. I won't participate in his ungodliness. I'll have no fellowship with his ungodliness. But I'll sit at a bootlegger's table and I'll eat a meal with him and talk to him about Jesus and try to get him saved. But I'm going to tell you, mister, I'm not fooling around a bunch of back-scratching, air-tickling, gospel-hating, blood-denying modernists. I'm not going to do it. God Almighty told me to come out from among them, and God told me to separate myself from them, and I'm going to do it. it, so help me God. They claim to be wiser than I am. They claim to have more wisdom than God's fundamental Bible preachers. Why should I try to help that gang? They don't want any help. They're willingly ignorant. They're blinded by the devil. They love it. They like it. And they don't have any intention of changing their mind. Well, all my time is slipping away, and here I am still on number one. Paul said, be not unequally yoked. And then in the same letter, in the 17th verse, 2 Corinthians 6:17, Paul said, touch not the unclean. Touch not. Not only come out, but God bless you, touch not the unclean. Touch not. We, as believers and followers of the Son of God, we are commanded to touch not the unclean. And that's negative. That's negative. Some of you, dear women, bless your precious heart. You go to the dance with your husband. You say, I'm afraid if I don't go, that I won't be able to get him to go to church with me. Well, it doesn't do any good after you get him to go. Because when you compromise with him by going to the places of ungodliness and filth, and playing cards and dancing and running around to these places with your husband, he doesn't have any confidence in you. If you profess to be a Christian, listen, you can't compromise with the devil, and you can't compromise with the world and hope to get sinners saved. You can't do it. You've got to touch not, love not. In other words, be not, touch not. And then number three, 1 John 2:15. 1 John 2:15, Paul gives us the first two. John gives us the next one. Love not the world, neither the things in the world. If any man love the world, the love of God's not in him. Is that clear? Or shall we write Dr. Sounding Brass and get him to discuss it in his, magazine or newspaper or radio question box? Shall we call up Dr. Sounding Brass and ask him what that strange verse of Scripture means? Love not the world, neither the things in the world. If any man love the world, the love of God's not in him. Is that clear? Is that clear? Do we need somebody to translate that? Love not? You know what it means to love not. Love not the world. He's not talking about the dirt. He's talking about worldly systems. Love not the world, neither the things in the world. If any man loves the world, love of God's not in him. Is that clear? That's clear. Why don't you believe it? Some of you sit at home on Wednesday night, God bless you, play cards, drink cocktails and highballs, watch TV, listen to the radio, or whatever. It doesn't make any difference. Sit at home when you know the prayer meeting bell has rung and you don't go. Revival night, you don't go. Sunday night, you don't go. You read every magazine, everything else under heaven, but your Bible lies on the table covered in dust, and then you have the audacity and the brass to tell me that you're a Christian. The Bible says if you love the world, the love of God's not in you. And if the world occupies the time in your life that the Word of God should occupy, then you love the world. And the fruits that you're bearing certainly testify that you love the world. And you know you love the world. If you loved God, you'd read His Word. If you loved God, you'd go to church. If you loved God, you'd serve Him. You wouldn't serve the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life, and the lust of other things. You wouldn't do it. So just face the thing. Love not. Love not. Be not. Touch not. Love not. Then the third one is Paul, or the fourth one rather, is Paul again. In Colossians 3:2, Paul said, set not your affections upon things on this earth. He said, set your affections on things above and not on things. So that's set not. Set not your affections on things of earth, on this earth. Listen, in other words, it is the same statement that John makes, except Paul makes it in a little different way, in a little different words. In other words, set not your affections on things on earth. Don't fall in love with the systems of this earth, because you can't love the systems of this sinful earth and love God at the same time. Just can't do it. Now that's the fourth one. I can't stay there because I do want to give you the references of all seven. The fifth one is walketh not. Now that's in Psalm 1:1. You know that one. Blessed is the man, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Now, some of you people, listening to Oliver Green's voice right now. You listen to some religious advisor who leaves the Son of God and the blood out of everything he says, and you've never heard him preach a red-hot sermon on hell fire in your life, and yet you take his advice. You're walking in the counsel of the ungodly. Now, if you want to walk in the right counsel, you walk in the counsel of God, not the ungodly, but the godly. Now, that's negative. Walk not. And then, of course, I must hurry on. And the sixth one is give not. Now, that's Matthew 7 and verse 6. Give not that which is holy unto dogs. Matthew 7 and verse 6. And I want you to get your Bible and I want you to read these verses. And I want you to follow them and study them and believe them. And it doesn't make any difference what Dr. Sounding Brass or Professor Tinkling Cymbal or the Right Reverend, most noble, esteemed Mr. Anybody or anybody else. It doesn't make any difference what they say. Don't you believe them? Listen, in Matthew 7 and verse 6, give not that which is holy unto dogs. Neither cast ye your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under your feet and turn again to rend you. You think I'd sit down and argue with a man that says he don't believe in the virgin birth of the Son of God? Do you think I'd argue with him? You think I'd argue with a man that told me that he didn't believe the blood of Jesus Christ could cleanse anybody from sin? Do you think I'd sit down and take the holy scriptures that talk about the blood and let him trample them under his feet? You think I'd do it? God Almighty don't intend for me to do it. God don't expect it, and God don't want you to do it. Listen, I'll sit with a poor old sinner all night, all day, all night, all day. And I'll reason and pray and weep with him. But I'll never sit and argue with a modernist, an atheist, or an agnostic. I'll never argue with them 2 minutes. My Bible says, give not that which is holy to dogs. And he says, cast not your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn again and rend you. Now, we have some willing ignorance in this country today, and you couldn't change them, God bless you, if you talk till you're blue in the face. They have their minds made up, they're willingly ignorant, and they preach a lovey-dovey, pammy-mammy, sissy, back-scratching, air-tickling gospel that never mentions the devil, hell, sin, or anything else but the birds and bees and flowers and lovely folks this and lovely folks that, and have one little service.